Well, it's like you and I using talcum powder. It's their way of drying off.
And does the mud actually help them at all?
Does it
have any purpose?
It keeps the flies away from them, acts as a sun barrier. And, you know, in general, it makes them feel very comfy. Helps the skin as well, because then they can rub against the tree and get rid of any dead skin that's built up over the body.
So they love this bit then?
Yeah, they do, as you can see.
I think I just got a mud bath then. I can't believe a minute ago they were clean and now they're dirty. And you need another wash. Yes, thanks.
The dust bath over, it was time to brush it all off. This is done to help improve the bond between the elephants and the keepers.
So Lynn, how serious is the threat to Asian elephants in the wild?
Unfortunately, at the moment, it's very bad. There's probably only 35 to 40,000 left out in the wild.
Could they become extinct?
They could. They reckon over the next sort of 25, 50 years, the numbers are just diminishing all the time.
I just couldn't imagine a world without elephants. Woburn Abbey here is nearly 900 years old. It began life as a monastery, but was confiscated by King Henry VIII. His son, Edward VI, gave it to a friend, who later became the Earl of Bedford, and it's been in his family ever since.
Oh, Lady Isabella, I do hope I haven't kept you.
Oh, it was here that afternoon tea is said to have begun.
Oh, could I interest you in a spot of tea? Oh, I would love a spot of tea.
Anna Maria, the wife of the 7th Duke, came up with the idea. She found the time between lunch and dinner too long. She was always hungry, so a light tea was served late afternoon in the blue drawing room.
Wait, are you a meringue person or are you more of a...
Well, I'd like to try one on the beach, really.
Oh, you can certainly try one on the beach. Those ones
do have a good appetite.
Simply marvellous. I say, Lady Isabella, pace yourself, one at a time.
One duchess in particular stands out in Woburn's history. She was known as the Flying Duchess.
The Duchess's name was Mary Duke Roy Tribe. Her early life had been quiet and simple. She had never expected to become a Duchess. But when she was 22, she fell in love with Herbrand Russell, the younger son of the Duke of Bedford.
Herbrand and Mary both loved animals and the countryside, so they married and went to live in a wild and remote part of Scotland. Soon, Mary discovered she was going to have a baby, and she was very happy.
One day, just before Christmas, the young couple were out walking on the wild moors. It was bitterly cold, and suddenly, to her horror, Mary realised she was about to give birth. The only shelter was a tumble-down shack, and it was here, a few hours later, that her son Hastings was born, on a bed of heather. Not long afterwards, her husband became the Duke of Bedford, and Mary's simple life was over. Now she was a duchess living in one of Britain's stateliest homes. But Mary was unimpressed by wealth and grandeur. In an age when most rich women showed little interest in practical matters, Mary raised eyebrows by driving her own Rolls-Royce, carrying out any repairs and changing tyres by the side of the road.
Always unconventional, Mary felt that she must do something useful with her life, so she decided to start up her own hospital here at Woburn.
She didn't play at nursing. For Mary, this was a vocation, and she was very good at it. She helped in countless operations and became a highly skilled radiologist, conducting X-ray examinations at a time when this was still a new technique.
The Duchess worked tirelessly to help her patients, despite having health problems of her own.
For Mary was slowly and painfully going deaf, her ears constantly filled with a noise she described as being like
railway trains rushing through stations.
Then, a friend suggested that maybe flying might help these noises in her head, as she called them.
One afternoon in 1926, a droning sound filled the air above Woburn Abbey.
Staff rush to the windows to see the Duchess high above them, passenger in a tiny plane. The plane circled again and again, and the Duchess would not let the pilot land until the last possible moment. She was 61 years old, and her new interest was to make her famous. People loved to hear of her amazing and adventurous antics, and the press soon nicknamed her the Flying Duchess. Mary didn't care about fame, but she was delighted to discover that she could actually hear better against the background of noise, and that the change in air pressure relieved the terrible buzzing in her ears.
Not satisfied with being just a passenger, she now set about learning to fly for herself.
She went on many pioneering trips, including a record-breaking 8-day flight to India, a 17-day return trip to South Africa, and a dangerous trek across the Sahara. Once, she was forced to crash-land her plane and had to make her way through the jungle to find shelter in a native's hut. On another occasion, she narrowly escaped with her life when her plane was shot at by desert tribesmen.
On her 70th birthday, she celebrated with half an hour's flying, and her adventures seemed likely to get more and more daring.
But Mary's noises were getting worse, and now her eyesight started to fail too. On March the 22nd, 1937, the Duchess took off from Woburn, planning to reach her target of 200 hours of solo flying. To do this, she had to fly for just 55 more minutes. The Duchess knew her planned route well, and the weather was good.
From her home, the 71-year-old Duchess of Bedford took off in her private plane for a short flight and then completely disappeared. Though how a plane can vanish into thin air in the heart of Britain is an almost uncanny mystery.
To this day, nobody knows what happened. 11 days later, this strut from her plane was found washed up at Yarmouth. There was no sign of the Duchess. But over the years, she has not been forgotten. Here at Woburn, there's a special room devoted to her memory. It's crammed full of personal reminders of a unique and colourful life.
What an incredible lady.
Oh, she certainly was.
Well, aside from all the animals at Woburn Park, there's lots of other things to do, like this. Are we ready, girls? 3, 2, 1, go!
It's not just the visitors who need refreshments on sweltering summer days. The animals often feel jaded by the sun too. So the keepers have come up with a novel idea for keeping them cool.
We are making ice lollies, can you believe? Now, Jake, who are we making them for?
We're making these for our 8 North American black bears.
So what do bears like in their lollies?
We've got a whole variety of fruit and veg here, and we've got these are crushed dog's biscuits and fruit and the nuts there and the sunflower seeds. A real wholesome kind of varied diet, all in a nicely packed ice lolly for them.
And do the other animals get lollies too, or is it just the bears?
No, our wolves get lollies with fish in them. The elephants get lollies with fruit and veg in them. We try and give it to as many of the animals as you can.
And the good thing about it is that it's actually a really healthy lolly. It's not a lolly in the sense that I like them, nice and sweet, lots of chocolate, but very nutritional
and very healthy. As you can see, it's a very balanced diet. There's everything there that keeps them happy and healthy.
I think I need a few finishing touches. I need some of this in.
It's the bear equivalent to hundreds and thousands.
A walk-in fridge.
That's right.
Once frozen, it was time to hand out the lollies.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your stress.
This is Georgie Bear.
Ah, Georgie Bear. Shall I throw one out to him?
Yep.
Oh, he looks as if he's thirsty. Could do with a nice cool down. There you go, Georgie. Get stuck into that.
Yum, yum.
Made that myself, Georgie. Lots of nice, yummy ingredients. Well, he's licking away at his lolly. I think Georgie really likes my cooking. Oh, I think he's pleased with that.
Brilliant, let's go.
Yep, let's deliver more lollies. Ready to give away my second lolly. Okay, here we go. Here's something to kill you down. Oh, is she going for it? And she's in the shade too, so she must be pretty hot, so that should cool her down. Oh look, she's scratching away at the surface. I think she's trying to get her claws into those nice ingredients. Oh, yummy. Ah, see, there's another bear coming over. He's heard the good news. There's lollies being given out. You know what? I'm really pleased. I think we've given a lolly to every single bear, and they're all loving it. Absolutely enjoying it.
Oh, and that is a heavy fella. This is a giant Malaysian pond turtle. Now, you may remember, we had three in our studio, and they had just been rescued by customs officials at Hong Kong Airport because they're very popular in Southeast Asia due to the trade in turtle meat. Well, I've come back to revisit our three friends who are settling in here now at Woburn. How are they doing?
They are doing really well. They've settled in brilliantly. They're getting on very well with the other species of turtle we've got in here as well, and they've found their own territories, so they are doing very well.
Now, every day you need to check them, don't you?
Yeah, we must check them every day. Just do a general health check. Just to make sure they've got no bites or any abrasions on any of the limbs. Right. Also just to make sure there's no shell damage or any mucus around the eyes or the mouth.
Ooh. Right, well, it's lunchtime now and we're going to feed our friend the lizard first because otherwise he'll eat everyone else's lunch, won't
he? He will.
Whoa, what fish is that?
That's a roach.
A roach. He's finding it quite difficult to just eat it without use of the hand.
He'll take that straight down in one.
No. Oh my gosh, down in one. What a greedy boy. There's loads of stuff in there, isn't there?
Yeah, there's lots of fruit. They get quite a big variety of fruit and vegetables.
Nice. Okay, so do we just chuck it in
the
water?
Yeah, all you need to do is just throw it into the water. Make sure it's scattered around.
Oh, Lizard's looking really hungry. Is he going to steal their food?
He might try.
So all over, basically?
Yeah, make sure it's covering all around the water so the turtles get a good selection.
Ah, look at them chomping away. They're having a great old dinner party. I think we should leave them to eat in peace. Bon appetit!
Sadly, we've come to the end of our time here at Woburn, but before we go, we just have to show you how much these lemurs love the camera.
They really do. I'm not sure what our crew make of them, though.
But don't forget, if you do want to visit the safari park and you do have a Blue Peter badge, well, you can get them for free. See you soon. Bye.
Bye.
A bit closer to
you. That's so funny, look at that.
Thanks guys, Blue Peter is back on your screens on